Back to the Future lifted the DeLorean to new heights and cemented its icon status for future generations. But it already had a fascinating backstory: drugs, agents, sports cars, a supermodel wife, a leading man who is a winner and a loser. For years, a number of people wanted to produce the DeLorean movie, but no one could get it done until now, thanks to a producer and passionate DeLorean fan from Chicago. Back to the Future presented the DeLorean as a time machine, but it's also a machine that's timeless, preserved by its beautiful Italian design and its backstory that takes the twists and turns of a Grand Prix.
When the Back to the Future came out, I was 5 years old. I sat in my first DeLorean when I was 6 years old. I saw it at a gas station. I remember it as if I was sitting there right now.
Welcome to my latest experiment. This is a big one, the one I've been waiting for all my life.
It's a DeLorean, right?
I asked the owner, can I jump in there? He's like, yeah, get in. I sit in it. I could barely, not even see over the steering wheel. And I remember saying to myself, I'm going to have one of these cars one day.
Tamir Ardan does own a DeLorean. He not only owns the car, but also the rights to the story.
The DeLorean. Gull-wing doors rise effortlessly, beckoning you inside.
Some younger movie fans may not realize there's a man behind the machine with the name DeLorean.
You know, he was a total maverick. He broke the rules, and he lived probably three lives within one life. History.
Drive the DeLorean. Live the dream today.
And this was the actual poster that John gave him.
His garage is a mini museum.
This is a custom thing that was actually made for John and sat on his New York executive desk.
Tamir is such a fan that one day in 1999, when he was 19 years old, he called John DeLorean himself at his Bedminster estate in New Jersey.
And he picked up, and I remember it too. He picked up, I was trembling on the phone, and he said, "Hello, this is Mr. DeLorean." I said, and I knew I had a 10-second range where this guy was either going to hang up on me or we were going to engage. And I said, "Mr. DeLorean, this is who I am. I made this website about you. I'm a huge fan. I'm going to be out there. Is there any way I can maybe stop by your house and meet you?" He said, "Of course, I'd love for you to do that. Just give me a call when you're out here." And so that's where my relationship with John DeLorean started. The moment you meet him, you're kind of in awe and you're like, I'm going to have a great time.
Drugs, FBI agents, sports cars, a supermodel wife. He was a leading man who was a winner and a loser. When DeLorean died in 2005, Tamir secured the rights to produce a film starring Alec Baldwin.
Allow me to introduce the first incarnation in the evolution of my dream.
It's part documentary, part drama, that allows the characters to explain to viewers part of the backstory.
Hero in his mind, he's a hero, and you have to play that. You have to play who he thinks he is, and you present him as who he thinks he is to the world.
The muscle car era really advanced Detroit.
Decades ago, General Motors was the biggest, most successful company in the world. John DeLorean helps create the first muscle car, the Pontiac GTO. Sales soar, but with his open collars and plastic surgery, DeLorean isn't the corporate type.
He sort of understood the idea of what the baby boomers wanted, which was this idea of unique image. And that was what he was feeding at GM. Now, what he wasn't able to do was sort of stay within the conforms of big business, which makes him an interesting character. He lived the way he wanted to live and told everyone else, you can shove it because I'm the one making all the money. If you want to do a story about who the first person to truly brand themselves was, it's John DeLorean.
He's on the cover of magazines. DeLorean could be president of GM, but he decides to go his own way. Stars like Johnny Carson and Sammy Davis Jr. invest millions, $17 million in all, to help build a prototype, the DeLorean. But now, where to build it? Some place that would give him tax breaks and subsidies.
Hey,
War-torn Belfast. Few companies would build here. But with so many out of work, the British Labour Party gives him incredible financial incentives. He's a hero in Northern Ireland. The first models roll off the assembly line. They look cool, but there are big problems in performance and cost. Then the Conservatives, led by Margaret Thatcher, take over and stop all the financial assistance. Suddenly, he needs money. That's when he gets an offer he should have refused.
The drug component is just, it's what makes the story, you couldn't make the up.
There aren't many people that could pick up the phone and get $30 million in 3 or 4 days without a lot happening.
James Hoffman offers a suitcase of cocaine. Hoffman is a former neighbor of DeLorean's and criminal informant. FBI agents arrest DeLorean.
Then they take risks outside of their normal sphere.
Between this and the other, it'll generate about four and a half million.
With Reagan's war on drugs getting underway, this is the high-profile bust the government wants.
The FBI and the DEA have been given the direction that we need to make high-profile busts. You know, it was the perfect storm for John DeLorean. How do you get John DeLorean off? He's sitting in a hotel room with a suitcase full of cocaine, you know, toasting. Like, how do you get someone like that off? It's just, you know, the guy's guilty.
It tears his family apart. He's married to model Christine Ferreira, and they have 2 children.
When they met is when Hoffman brought up the drug deal. And that, of course, wasn't recorded. When I spoke with the prosecutor, they basically said the case was lost the moment that occurred. You know, because that is the reasonable doubt, which is the golden goose of who brought it up first.
You know? Entrapment.
Entrapment.
Victorious on the courtroom steps in Los Angeles in 1984, but this is not a Hollywood happy ending.
Every single cent was legitimately and honestly come by. And
DeLorean abandons his inner circle to team up with Colin Chapman of Lotus to smooth out the production problems. But remember that $17 million from investors like Johnny Carson and Sammy Davis Jr.? Well, with all that government financial aid, DeLorean and Chapman decide to pocket the $17 million. Had he held on to it, he might not have needed the drug deal. But now he faces charges for failing to pay taxes on embezzled money.
Before, did you ever cheat someone or take advantage of anyone in a business deal?
Yes, I would say.
His wife tells investigators she witnessed DeLorean forging documents and aging them with a sun lamp, but he evades prosecution because of a legal technicality.
Because he was a very lucky man over the course of his life.
Safe to say that he left a lot of ruined relationships in his wake?
Yeah, it's funny. I mean, when I speak to anyone that knew John DeLorean, they either love him or hate him. His story is a cautionary tale, and you do 35, 40 years later, get to see the true collateral damage of it all.
I don't think I've sat in one of these probably since my dad had one on the farm.
Zach DeLorean is John's son.
His whole life, his whole dream, everything that he worked for from the time they broke ground till the time of the arrest, gone.
In the end, he's a born-again Christian, living in a one-bedroom apartment, doodling sketches of his next revolutionary vehicle when John DeLorean dies of a heart attack in 2005.
Maybe he had the wrong definition of success in life.
Yeah, we need people like that, to be honest with you. Like, we need John DeLoreans. We need those kind of people that are so singularly focused on trying to do new things, exciting things, where they're gonna have deficiencies in other part of their life and their personalities. I can see the good, bad, and the ugly in him, and I can appreciate all of it for what it's worth. Every single time I look at this car, open the door, start it up, I'm giddy inside. You know, it just doesn't get old. And I think that's what makes car lovers unique. Like, you just fall in love with the car and you love it for hopefully the rest of my life.
The DeLorean is not a true sports car. It's not fast like a Ferrari. Of the 8,000 made in 1981 and 82, several thousand still exist. Its big screen role as a time machine captures new generations of fans and stirs their imagination, something John DeLorean could appreciate. He always wanted a creation that was eternal.
It's really helped make the car iconic, and it will make it live on forever. I mean, it's something that young kids watch today and they get excited about the car. It's allowed the magic to live on.
The name of the film, Framing John DeLorean.